when he had a play in Comedia. Right. Okay. High Minor Community. John here. Yeah, it's been a while. Been quite busy. It's been a tremendous heat wave here in the UK. Well, I guess pretty much throughout Europe, I think, past couple of weeks. Cooler now, overcast, but it's bearable once again. I've just recently been on a trip to Sweden. I had a few errands I had to take care of over there, and so of course I took the opportunity while I was there to visit a few favourite record haunts, and I'm going to show you what I managed to pick up. I also got to meet up with a VC guy, somebody that I subscribe to, from Stockholm, and I think, yeah, you might enjoy seeing some footage of that in a little while. So, I arrived in Stockholm and went to a shop that I've been to before called Seria. Skivoxeriehandel, which is record and comic book place, and I picked up a few bits and pieces there. The first of which was this one. This is Joy, or Band of Joy. It's their second album. 24K. So this is the band that apparently Robert Plant and John Bonham were in before they went to join Led Zeppelin. Yeah, the jury's still out on this. I don't know what I think of it. It doesn't sound the way I expected it to. And this was made in, I think, what, 78? 83, sorry, 83. The first album by them was made in 78, I think. Which obviously is at, at the tail end of a Led Zeppelin existence. So apparently this band didn't do much before then. There you go. Well, it is what it is. But yeah, so it's a nice little find. Like I said, the jury's still out. Still sort of making up my mind about that. Next one I got was this is AC/DC, Blow Up Your Video. It's their 11th studio album. Not very popular with AC/DC fans, if I understand right. Yeah, for some reason this didn't really go down well. I think it was a bit of a low period for AC/DC, I think. Fly on the Wall, just not done so well. Yeah, it's not such a strong record, is it? I think this one's a bit better, but people think generally sort of tend to group them together. So this was the one that came out before The Razor's Edge, which is where I think things started picking up again. Anyway, I didn't have it on vinyl. I think I have it on cassette, actually. And partly got it from me, partly for my son too, I suppose. I'm sure he'll enjoy getting into it when I finish listening to it myself. And then I got a jazz compilation, The Giants of Jazz. I don't know if this is special or anything, but it's got a lot of the big names on it. Dave Brubeck Quartet, Miles Davis, Quincy Jones and the All-Stars, Duke Ellington, Thelonious Monk, J.J. Johnson, Bud Powell Trio, and a few more. It's all, for me, this is sort of part of my emerging understanding of jazz and appreciation of jazz. I picked this up because it's Yeah, fun. Didn't cost me an awful lot. We didn't have that. So that was at the shop. I think I got a few more other records there, but those are the three that I'm interested in showing. And then the day after, I went to. But the next day, I went up and took an hour or two and went to Salvation Army shop in a place called Ropsten, one of my favourite places to buy records. And technically, it's a large charity shop, but I've always found such great stuff there. And most of the time it's reasonably priced. First one I got there was this album, Rockpile, Seconds of Pleasure. Lovely copy, very good condition. And so it's Nick Lowe and Dave Edmonds. I think, I'd say that this is sort of part of that pub rock scene. This came out in 78, so I think it was after 78 or 80, slightly after that period. But, it kind of fits in with that, within that sort of genre, if you like. Dave Edmonds, it's basically his band, I think. His first album, under this title, Rockpile, was published on Swan Song, Led Zeppelin's label. This one wasn't there. And Nick Lowe, of course, you'll know through, he worked with, amongst other people, Elvis Costello. This was a nice little treat. I've seen this one shown many times on the vinyl community. So this is It's Just Begun, Jimmy Carter Bunch. Really fun record. I've often wondered about it. It's one of those ones on Dynaflex. You can see here it talks about Dynaflex. It is thinner than any record you have owned. And it truly is. It's that's crazy. And the concept is supposed to lie flat on your turntable, but I don't know. So it's a great record. Very funky, very soul-y. Yeah, like I said, come out in 72. It's one of those ones that I've seen lots of before people show it. And I often wonder about it. So glad to have found it. This one's a real cool one. It's Paris, Texas. It's a soundtrack album by Ry Cooda. I can remember back in the day watching this on video cassette. It's a very sort of atmospheric. What would you say? A very sort of atmospheric film. About this guy here going looking for a place called Paris, Texas, and the film is kind of accompanied by this really sort of nicely played, laid-back slide guitar music by Ry Cooda. Might even put a little bit of a needle drop to this because it's so nice to hear. Chris Yarno. I've got quite a lot of his records now. Many of them originally came from America with me when I was there. When I was last in Sweden last year, I even picked up a few there. It seems to be quite popular there. You don't see him very often here in the UK, at least not in South Wales anyway. What can I say? This is the one that came out after his biggie. The one that he did the cover of Light My Fire by The Doors. This is the album that came out after that. And it's pretty much in the same vein. Lovely to listen to. It's got a very strong Latin feel to it. I mean, he's Puerto Rican. So he has that very strong Puerto Rican accent and a sort of a flamenco quality to his guitar that he plays. Lovely stuff. The next album, okay, so this is a Swedish band called Stone Cake. This is an interesting find. I guess, yeah, if I'm going to find it anywhere, I'm going to find it in Sweden, aren't I? Let's see if you can see the label here. Label, Wire Records. They were popular in the early 90s in Sweden. I think quite a typical band for that time and place. There are other bands called like rock pop bands, pop rock bands, I don't know how you'd say. A bit like Sator, for instance, or The Creeps. Another band was called The Ark, very popular at the time, although I think they're technically still going. Yeah, it's good stuff. It reminded me a lot of XTC, because there's moments in here where they are obviously sort of including a sort of Beatles, Paul McCartney-esque sort of quality to their music, and I think their delivery is not a million miles away from the way XTC used to do it. Yeah, I'll do a needle drop of this, see what you think. An unusual one. Of course, it came out in 92, I think, which is the time when people basically stopped buying records. So I've seen this over the last 20 odd years in Sweden, in the library, for instance, on CDs. They're everywhere. It was a popular record of its time, but I've never seen it on vinyl, so it just popped up and I grabbed it. Really fun to have. And the last two records I'm going to show are by same band. This is Accept. So this is their third album, called Breaker. One of the more popular albums by them, I think. Accept are a German heavy metal band. This is, pretty much traditional heavy metal. It's what you'd expect, really. It's on Brain label, there you go. And I didn't have this. I've got the first album and the fifth, and so I was glad to pick this one up. Good find. Yeah, very much traditional metal, and one of the more popular ones, I think, in their catalogue. And then the next one I got was their fourth album, called Restless and Wild. Again, that's on Brain too. And this is interesting because I think it came in 83. It's very much, what would you say, it's very much a, it's almost sort of right at the beginning of thrash. I don't know if I'd describe this album as being a thrash album, but it's certainly they're heading in that direction. Many bands may have even listened to this and felt inspired to kind of get their thrash on. I don't know. Okay, so those are the ones that I got on the second day. So on the Wednesday, the next day I was there, I arranged to meet up with a VC guy in Stockholm, and he took me to too many record shops to mention. I can't even remember how many we went to, but in the region of about 6 or 7, and many of these ones that, in fact all of these ones I'd never been to before, and I'd heard the names of one or two of them, but I'd never been there or even attempted to try and find them, but he knew all of them. So he and I walked around Stockholm in the south part, I suppose you'd say, and we visited many of them. And there were even some that he didn't take me to because I was just kind of overwhelmed by once you've been in one record shop, many of them afterwards kind of all feel a bit the same, don't they? And I picked up one or two albums along that way. So have a look at this footage and see what we got up to. Sorry again for the shaky camera, can't do much about that. And I'll show you what I found afterwards. So here we are, Alden Plan. I've come to meet a VC guy that I subscribe to. It's called Mikael, or Michael in English, but Mikael in Swedish. Arranged to meet him at a coffee house here. So we'll have a chat and go check out some record shops, I think.
I'm sorry.
That two corns second hand. for records.
Hey.
Film a little bit before Cosmo's factory, right next door to the Great Britain. It's crazy that there's two shops that sell basically the same thing. Next one. Okay, let's go in. Oh. Sea of records. And toys. And more records. And more records. Oh my god. Even more.
Sisters, we're all sick
of that. Just a never ending supply of records. Where do all these used records come from, I wonder? Incredible. I'm going to try and test the limits of this place and see if I can find something unusual. So we ended up here in the Beefeater pub in Stockholm. Sort of like a
British theme pub. I think I probably came here once or twice when I lived here in the beginning. But learned after a while that the only thing British about it is the name. Maybe the tartan wallpaper. Apart from that, it's not really British at all, but we stopped here for a beer. It's a really warm day outside, so nice to take a break and look at our records. We've got some fun things I'll show you.
So here we are in Slissen, in Stockholm. It's like the lock. I don't know how you describe that. And so I'm here with Micke. What is your name on the...
Dub Music.
Dub Music?
Dub Music.
Yeah. Okay, and we've had a great day record collecting. Sunk a few beers. And we're going to go our way home. But I hope you enjoyed the video. Okay, so... first of all, we went to the Stadsmissioner. I don't know how you'd say that in English, and see if I can look it up and write it here, which is basically a big sort of charity chain in Sweden, and that was pretty cool. It was really good. So there I picked up this one, purple, Machine Head. I had this on picture disc, and I still have it on picture disc. Never had sort of a proper copy before, so very happy to found that. And then I also got this one, the amazing Jimmy Smith Trio. Call out to Liz, who I know likes Jimmy Smith. I like him too. This is a pretty cool find. You can see the label there, Tip Stereo. Stayed there for a short while, pretty impressed. That's certainly a place I'll be going back to next time I'm in Stockholm. And then we went further on to a couple of other shops, or a few other shops. Nostalgia Palazzet, another record shop. I can't remember, but I think there were two record shops side by side, which I thought was kind of crazy. Two independent record shops right next door to each other. No, you'd have thought, you know, that would have been a bad idea, but apparently not. I guess they attract people there because of how tight they are. I can't remember which shops now I bought these in, but this was one recommended by my friend McGear, Duke Ellington, New Orleans suite. I was umming and ahhing between this one and another one, and he suggested if you're going to buy one or the other, I recommend this one. And I'm glad I did. Lovely record. It's Duke Ellington is playing an organ, not unlike Jimmy Smith does, actually. Sure.